Hi, how are you?
Bill.
Hi, how are you?
Great to see you. It was a long time.
You haven't changed at all.
Oh, thank you.
You haven't.
It always was charming.
No, you haven't changed.
Hello, John Wilson.
Hi, John.
Hello, nice to meet you. Thanks for coming in.
It's been more than 30 years since former trade union leader Lord Bill Morris worked at the car component firm GKN Driveline, in his day known as Hardy Spicer.
This is where the old conference room was, wasn't it?
Exactly.
It hasn't changed at
That's
all.
What Maury was just telling me.
Yeah, it hasn't changed at all. There's been a few stories told in this room.
Bill joined the company in 1954 and left nearly 20 years later to begin his ascent up the union ranks. He became leader of the Transport and General Workers Union in 1993.
So where's Goldie?
He's going to be here.
Lord Bill, as he signs off his emails, is meeting me here in Birmingham along with former colleagues, manager Maureen Constantine and union convener Graham Gold.
Ah, oh, here's the man.
Hello, Bill. I can't see you.
How are you, mate? Nice
to see you.
Good to see you.
After his retirement from the union, Bill Morris was knighted and then made a peer of the realm, more than 50 years after he first left Jamaica with his mother to come to Britain looking for work. But his successful career all began here, as an 18-year-old in overalls on the shop floor at Hardy Spicer.
Oh, my job was a simple one, drilling holes in components. I drill them, vertically, I drill them horizontally. You name them, I drill them.
Did you enjoy the work?
No, I didn't. I think it was quite boring, actually. But the pay was decent. Yes, and the friendship and the camaraderie was great, It was a pleasure to come to work, not for the money, but just the environment.
And did you join the union as soon as you started on the shop floor?
No, I didn't join on the first day. But when I did join, I was very clear about its purpose, about the values which trade unionism brings.
So did the union present you with an opportunity then? Did you feel ambitious, in fact, as a union man?
It wasn't a planned career, let's put it like this. It was a set of circumstances which developed and took on a life of its own. After I joined the union and the union became active here, it was an opportunity then for me to step up to the plate and take responsibility. I was elected as the shop steward for my section, just down 500 yards from here. Subsequently, I was elected by the TNG shop steward to become their senior steward, which meant that I was working very closely with Graham as the chairman of the joint the committee on a daily basis.
Graham Gold, you were the convener for four unions here at Hardy Spicer. Do you remember the young Bill Morris when you first met him? Did you see potential for a good union man?
We have had some hectic moments in here. And one comes to mind about Bill, we were at a meeting, and his friend Frank Piper, and Bill gets upset, and he jumps up, and he points at him. I'll have your head on toast. And Piper went white. And Bill went out the door.
What had Mr. Piper done to you?
I can't remember what the issue was. But I tell you something, that was a seminal moment, and it's one of the sort of reference point in my life as I became a full-time officer. Because I walked out of the meeting, I went back on my section and I was working, and I expect that somebody would come along and says, come back, please, and come back. A day went. And nobody came near me to beg me to come back, So after about 2 days, I thought, I've had enough of this. Because I'm having to work, which is how it was supposed to be. So anyway, the moral is never walk out. Because if you do, at some point, you have to walk back. And you've lost the moral ground. So that's a tremendous lesson for me, which I took throughout my trade union career.
In the 1960s, Bill and his colleagues were part of Britain's car manufacturing boom, working on prop shafts for the Mini.
And then the bearings go in there, and then those bearings are critical to success.
If four hulking great six footers and their baggage can travel comfortably in an Austin 7 or Morris Mini Minor, and they can, you can be sure those amazing twins make marvelous family cars. And they do, with plenty of room for everyone and everyone's cases. What a boon the let-down boot lid is.
The Mini was a hit and the workforce wanted a share. As a union rep, Bill Morris found himself in the battleground of industrial relations. On the opposite side of the negotiating table was Maureen Constantine, who had joined Hardy Spicer's parent company, GKN, as a graduate management trainee. One of her early placements was to the JIC, the Joint Industrial Committee, where she sat in management and union meetings with Bill and Graham.
Now, it was quite unprecedented for the JIC to let some junior person like me sit in and listen, and a woman as well. You know, this was 1970, so it was quite remarkable. It wasn't all headbutting stuff. We had our moments, definitely, but it was what I perceived to be responsible trade unionism.
I presume some of those moments would have taken place here in this room. Yeah. We're in the meeting room.
Pay negotiations always tended to be volatile. There was a degree of not exactly play-acting, but really going for it in order to win your point. And it was the same from the other side. But we would have meetings that could last 3, 4, 5 hours during pay negotiations. And, of course, at that time, everybody smoked. And the room would be filled with cigarette smoke. There'd be one moment when everybody would be head-to-head, and the next moment we'd all be laughing together. And we never left a meeting being really angry with each other, and that was something that we worked on. Now, given the general industrial relations climate in the UK at the time, with a lot of strikes going on and so on, we never had a strike here at Hardy Spicer in all of the time that I was here that was as a result of some major disagreement between the union and the company.
They may have locked horns over industrial relations during the day, but after clocking off, Maureen and Bill were both members of the Hardy Spicer Ballroom Dancing Society.
I wanted the Hardy Spicer employees to learn to do the limbo. And I thought the best way of working into that is for me to suggest to learn to do ballroom dancing. I think I failed on both counts.
I used to stand next to him, and once or twice I had my foot trodden on.
I don't think either of us would do well in come dancing.
And on a personal level, of course, you became Britain's first black union leader. But in the 1970s, I mean, we talk about industrial relations, but have been bound up with a sense of volatile race relations as well, particularly in a city like Birmingham.
Sure.
On a personal level, did you encounter racism either at the workplace or doing your job as a union leader?
Oh, yes, but I have to tell you, in the first rejection that I had on the basis of race, ironically came out of the Transport Engine Workers Union. Because I applied for my first full-time officer post at an office of the union located in Smedic. And I had my interview like everybody else. I felt I did as well as could be expected. I did enough, because you know when you've done well. Anyway, I didn't get the job. When I went to my next executive meeting, I met a colleague, and he was very embarrassed. And I said, "What's your problem?" And he told me that the senior officer who was leading the delegation, the deputy general secretary of the day, persuaded the appointment committee that they should not appoint me because the union was not ready for a black officer. So that was my first encounter with race.
Actually, like, when you go back over the periods, we probably was the first companies in Birmingham or in this area to do the things that we done. We was the first one, if you like, to have a coloured senior steward. In looking back, like, the whole thing come very close, because just before Bill left, I had to tell him, like, that he was been put forward for the white coat.
And what would the white coat have meant?
A foreman, and he moved into management.
A supervisor, yes.
Yeah, and it could have led to a management job then.
Well, you know, you never know. And I always fancied one of those white coats, you know. My whole life was dedicated for that, because my supervisor used to stroll down with his hand in his pocket, you know. I thought, I could handle some of that.
Was it the coat or was it the desk job that you had your eye on?
I think it was the coat.
But did you ever, when you were standing there drilling holes on the shop floor, did you ever think, I could be a manager. I could be part of the management
team. Oh, yeah, yeah, no, sure.
And that was a quiet ambition in your head.
It was latent there. It was.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.